we now have our last speaker of the morning session. He is Dionysios Christias from the University of Patras. He will talk about thinking with sailors and beyond sailors on the relations between philosophy and the history of philosophy. Okay, please, Dionysios.
Thank you. I would first like to thank the organizers of this great conference, Antonio and Luca. Thanks very much. So the topic of my presentation is to investigate what a Sellarsian might have to say on the relations between philosophy and the history of philosophy. I don't know how much of what I have to say will be strictly Sellarsian or just inspired by Sellars, but you judge it. You'd be the judge of this. The purpose is to sketch a Sellarsian or at any rate a Sellars inspired view of on this metaphilosophical issue. It will be suggested that Sellars' metaphilosophy can provide support for the thesis that the history of philosophy is internally related to what philosophy is, in that the former is implicated in the very content of philosophical problems. In order to show this, we shall first sketch a post-Kantian critical conception of philosophy, according to which the latter can be practiced adequately only if it is self-critical and self-reflective, that is, only if it makes a conscious effort to make explicit and justify its own methods and presuppositions and identify its limits. So the connection between this post-Kantian critical conception of philosophy and the metaphilosophical issue that concerns us here emerges if we realize that the philosophical framework can be self-reflective and self-critical only if, among other things, it incorporates its history in its own subject matter and attempts to understand and critically engage with it. So it will be suggested that support for the above conception of the relations between philosophy and the history of philosophy can be found in Sellars' rejection of the myth of the given in all its forms, including what might be called the myth of the philosophical given. We'll see what this is, as well as in Sellars' well-known distinction between the manifest and the scientific image, understood as operating at a metaphilosophical level. So, as is well known, unlike most analytic philosophers, Sellars had the highest respect for the history of philosophy, offering novel interpretations of major figures in the history of philosophy, such as Plato, Aristotle, Descartes, Locke, Berkeley, Hume, Leibniz, and above all, Kant. He is also known for suggesting that the history of philosophy is the lingua franca, which makes communication between philosophers, at least of different points of view, possible. Philosophy without the history of philosophy, as he said, is, if not empty or blind, is at least dumb. Yet I take it that for Sellars, the importance of the history of philosophy is not exhausted in its facilitating communication among different philosophical perspectives. The history of philosophy is more intimately connected with philosophy proper. It seems to be implicated in the very content of contemporary philosophical problems. We will not here attempt to derive Sellars' views on the relations between philosophy and the history of philosophy from his own scattered remarks about the issue. Instead, as we mentioned, we shall first sketch a metaphilosophical view according to which the internal relation between philosophy and the history of philosophy follows from a certain way of understanding philosophy proper, and then argue that the Sellarsian rejection of the myth of the given in all its forms, as well as the Sellarsian distinction between the manifest and the scientific image, understood as operating at a metaphilosophical level, can throw light on the specific way in which philosophy is internally related to the history of philosophy. So, the critical turn in philosophy, inaugurated by Kant and his Critique of Pure Reason, and completed by Hegel, developed an essentially self-critical and self-reflective conception of the philosophical enterprise. Kant was the first to see that traditional metaphysical doctrines of the past, by supposing that there are some eternal necessary entities out there in the world, as it is in itself, corresponding to the laws of reason, or to the necessity of reason, were essentially forms of transcendental illusion produced by the self-hypostasis of reason. Building on this Kantian critique of metaphysics, Hegel went even further and took Kant to task for not seeing that the transcendental illusion in question could find expression even in philosophy's conception of the source of its own doctrines. There was no reason to suppose, according to Hegel at least, that the doctrines of Kantian critical philosophy were themselves a product of pure reason, as Kant believed. Kant critical philosophy seemed in this way to fail to live up to its own standards of self-critical reflection. For only a philosophy aware of its own methods, presuppositions, and limits could be truly self-critical and self-reflective one. And this contra Kant seems to demand that philosophy be aware of the genesis, context, and development of its own doctrines. So, from this point of view, only if philosophy were historicized could the problem of transcendental illusion be fully eradicated. Correlatively, it is only in this way that a philosophy could aspire to be truly presuppositionless, not by abstracting from the historical process that brought it into being and simply relying upon one's individual reason, as in Descartes, as Descartes and even Kant effectively believed, but by incorporating its own history within itself. So, according to this line of thought, the most pervasive source of dogmatism in philosophy, its transcendental illusion, lies in forgetting the origin, context, and development of its own ideas. And this is because if a philosophy lacks this special kind of self-awareness, the awareness of the genesis, context, and development of its own doctrines, it thereby lacks the resources to uncover and hence overcome its own deeply immersed, unquestioned background assumptions, which organize and coordinate the worldview expressed in the philosophical system in question. These background assumptions seem virtually unchallengeable, precisely because being the organizing principles for a wide range of practices in which we think, act, and deal with the world, they become so embedded in our manner of thinking and acting that they are never thematized as such, not even at the level of philosophical thinking, which whose aim is precisely to make explicit the presupposition of thought. In this way, those background assumptions seem to be characterized by a certain deeply ingrained naturalness, a presumption of uniqueness which goes without saying, thereby creating the impression that a certain philosophical worldview is the only game in town, and the illusion that genuine alternatives to that worldview are not even thinkable. Moreover, by not being able to even identify the unstated assumptions that stand in the background of its explicitly formulated thesis and arguments, a philosophical system is thereby unable to identify its own limits and hence cannot transcend them. I take it that the above conception of philosophy as an essentially self-critical and self-reflective enterprise, and as something which is internally related to the history of philosophy, would be congenial to Sellars. Indeed, we can find some corroboration for this claim in his not so well-known article, The Double Knowledge Approach to the Mind-Body Problem, where Sellars explicitly says that a philosophy which is largely unaware of its historical antecedents cannot be truly critical, and as a result, it is bound to make old mistakes anew. But for the time being, we will explore a more roundabout way in which Sellars' philosophy can be considered as truly critical in the above sense, which, though not found in Sellars' explicit metaphilosophical writings, is perhaps one of the most important and pervasive features of Sellarsian philosophy as a whole. So, Specifically, it can be suggested that Sellars' rejection of the myth of the given, for a certain form of the myth of the given, among other things, goes hand in hand with a rejection of an ahistorical, time-transcendent conception of the structure of the mind, thought, or reason. And if this time-transcendent conception of mind, thought, or reason is rejected in all its forms, including certain transcendental conceptions of mind or reason which equate the notion of the a priori with that of categorical unrevisability, the way is clear then for recognizing that philosophy itself, to the extent to which it is an investigation of the relation of the mind, thought, or reason with the world, cannot be an ahistorical discipline, but has an essentially historical dimension. How exactly does the rejection of the myth of the given lead to the corresponding rejection of an ahistorical conception of the mind, or thought, or reason? We can see this if we reflect on the Sellarsian notion of the categorical given. As Sellars says, to fall prey to the myth of the categorical given is to believe that if a person is directly aware of an item which in fact has categorical status C, then the person is aware of it as having categorical status C, or to hold that the categorical structure of the world, more general definition, if it has a categorical structure, imposes itself on the mind as a seal imposes an image on a melted wax. Also, a form of the myth of the categorical given is to believe that there is an awareness of logical space or of categorical space independently of our initiation in language. The interesting thing to notice in these general definitions of the categorical given is that despite first appearances, the given element which imposes its categorical structure on the mind, as a seal imposes an image on the melted wax, need not be something radically external to the mind or some kind of sensory or perceptual experience only, but may well be the mind itself or reason itself, transcendentally considered, at least to the extent to which we are thereby supposed to be unable to reveal its necessary categorical, structure by the sole use of a decidedly non-empirical and non-hypothetical transcendental investigation. But this means that even some versions of transcendental philosophy, namely those according to which there is a sui generis level of transcendental description, for example, of the necessary categorical features of our mind or thought or reason, which is impervious to recategorization on the basis of scientific theorizing or hypothetical philosophical concept formation, at least, about the world and the mind, fall prey to the myth of the categorical given. According to this Sellarsian line of thought, since we are bereft of intellectual intuition, the categorical structure of the world or of our minds themselves does not imprint itself on our minds as a seal imprints itself on wax. Hence, we do not have a kind of transparent epistemic access to or knowledge of the categorical structure of reality or of the mind. Extending this line of thought, Sellars, I think, in essence, holds that knowledge of the world and knowledge of our conceptually or categorically structured means of accessing the world, of the mind, of thought, or reason, are on the same footing, advanced hand in hand, and are subject to historical development through a critically controlled process of mutual self-correction. Now it can be suggested that an instance of the myth of the categorical given is what might be called the myth of the philosophical given. Sellars does not use this notion, of course. That is the view according to which philosophy, due to its essential reliance, for example, on pure reason, has transparent epistemic access to its essence or subject matter. Or the view that the subject matter of philosophy is given to the mind or to reason. And to reject the myth of the philosophical given amounts, I think, to realizing that the power of reason that mankind now possesses and philosophy makes explicit is not given to it at birth, as it were, but has been acquired through centuries of effort, through the cultural inheritance and occasional revision of the categorical structure of language from generation to generation. Recall that the myth of the categorical given goes hand in hand with the rejection of all forms of Platonism about meanings, the mind, thought, or reason. The object of thought is not a timeless form complete in all its meaning prior to our reflection upon it in our practices, and the reflection upon it is not an eternal contemplation, a passive intuition or timeless perception of these forms. Instead, the object of thought is not given to, but in a sense created by our thinking about it. In good Hegelian fashion, we can say that it is posited by the very act of discovering its meaning. Now, notice that in Sellars, this view does not have any idealistic overtones to the extent that he holds this view, since Sellars is careful to distinguish a space of reasons from a space of causes, let's say, sense of the term object of thought. The object of thought in the space of reason sense has logical or conceptual structure, while it belongs to the realm of facts, while the object of thought in the space of causes sense has only empirical, that is, non-logical and non-conceptual structure, and maybe radically different from what we take it to be in the context of our manifest image categorical framework. So the above view is about the space of reason sense of the term object of thought. So we can say, I think, in good Hegelian fashion, that the object of thought in the space of reason sense of the term is posited by the very act of discovering its meaning. But this means, among other things, I think, that the mind or reason itself discovers itself through its historical development. So to reject the myth, I think, of the philosophical given, correlatively, amounts to realizing that philosophy, to the extent to which it is essential investigation of the relation of mind or reason with the world, is internally connected to the history of philosophy, in that the history of philosophy is precisely the place where this self-discovery of mind or reason is explicitly articulated or is made explicit. In other words, the history of philosophy is an expression or crystallization in a specific time in history of mind's or reason's conception of itself, themselves, through their historical development. Hence, bereft as we are of any transparent access, for example, intellectual intuition, into the essence of mind or reason, it seems that the only way in which we can know our way around with respect to those things and the way they relate to the world is to thematize, understand, and critically engage with the history of philosophy, which is precisely what makes the conceptual development of these notions explicit. So, shall now further suggest that at a more specific level, Sellars' metaphilosophical construal of the manifest image and Sellars' metaphilosophical construal of the manifest image and the scientific image of man in the world can be helpful for understanding the way in which philosophy proper is internally related to the history of philosophy. Notice, for example, to see this, that Sellars explicitly says that the notions of the manifest image and the scientific image are idealizations which are designed to illuminate the inner dynamics of the development of philosophical ideas. He says this in his Philosophy and the Scientific Image of Man, where he says the following also. He adds in the next sentence from this one that from a somewhat different point of view, the notions of the manifest and scientific image can be compared to the ideal types of Weber's sociology. Both of these points suggest that the distinction between the manifest and the scientific image is metaphilosophical and is designed to illuminate, that is, to provide the kind of explanation of the historical development of philosophical ideas. This means that those metaphilosophical conceptual tools, among other things, provide the framework in which we can make sense of the history of philosophy. So, for example, recall how Sellars in Philosophy and the Scientific Image of Man attempts to show that modern and contemporary forms of epistemological skepticism are the result of an immature attempt by early modern philosophy to replace the categorical ontology of the manifest image with that of the emerging scientific image. For example, this is in the systems of Descartes, Spinoza, Locke, and Hume. By attacking the manifest image conception of nature. In this way, perceptual and affective qualities were ultimately construed as objective states of the human mind projected onto an external world, now understood in terms of relations, causal relation, and properties of imperceptible particles, and hence devoid of qualitative content. Sellars also sees the transcendental turn of Kant's philosophy as an attempt to salvage the sound core of the manifest image, our freedom, rationality, and autonomy of persons, and insulate it from the attack of the scientific image, while simultaneously accounting for the objectivity of the scientific image. Kant's attempt, however, according to Sellars, remained unsuccessful and skeptical or dualist in its form, mainly due to Kant's overly restrictive picture of the scientific image. According to Kant's control of the scientific image, it is incompatible with the freedom of the will or the autonomy of reason. But this is not the sole metaphilosophical function of this fundamental and large distinction between those two basic ways of understanding the world and ourselves. As is well known, Sellars believes that this distinction also illuminates the content of many different and seemingly disparate contemporary philosophical views or systems. That is to say, according to Sellars, the very formation of the ideological space or battlefield of contemporary philosophical ideas or philosophical frameworks can also be understood in terms of the manifest scientific image distinction. Recall, for example, Sellars' conviction to the effect that such seemingly unrelated or disparate philosophical frameworks, as the major schools of continental thought, such as phenomenology or existentialism, and contemporary British and American philosophies of common sense, such as Strawson's Oxford Aristotelianism or Austin's Ordinary Language and the later Wittgenstein's philosophy, are at bottom sophisticated philosophical systematizations of the manifest image, a categorical framework of man in the world, which moreover take the manifest image as ultimately real. They privilege its categorical framework in relation to the categorical framework of the scientific image. Furthermore, it can be suggested, though Sellars himself is less clear on this point, that the manifest scientific image distinction also serves as a metaphilosophical tool which throws light to the very emergence of philosophical problems in general and even to the emergence of philosophy itself as a discipline. So, as we saw above, the relevance of the manifest scientific image distinction for explaining the emergence of philosophical problems in modernity is, in a sense, plausible or obvious. For Sellars, at bottom, philosophical problems and the characteristic skeptical anxieties they arouse spring from the conflict between our manifest image conception of ourselves and the world and the radically disenchanted image of ourselves and the world offered by the scientific image. In effect, I think that the manifest and the scientific image are at bottom theoretical expressions of the cultural process of what Weber called the disenchantment of the world and of ourselves. That is the gradual overcoming of magical or anthropomorphic ways of understanding the world and ourselves so through a process of relentless depersonalization of explanation, which threatens to extinguish even persons themselves. It is exactly this basic feature of modernity, that is the process of the disenchantment of nature, that stands behind the characteristically modern, radical disconnection of what Sellars calls the logical space of reasons, which represents our manifest image conception of ourselves as possessors of distinctively human characteristics such as freedom, rationality, deliberation, from the radical disconnection between the logical space of reasons from the logical space of causes and effects, which articulates our modern scientific image conception of natural processes. In this way, the connection between the manifest and the scientific image distinction and the distinctively modern philosophical problems, I think, does seem somewhat plausible. But one might wonder, what is the explanatory value of the manifest scientific image distinction in the case of the emergence of problems in pre-modern philosophy or in the emergence of philosophy itself as a discipline? I'm not going to say anything about the first problem, how the manifest scientific image distinction relates to explicating the problems of pre-modern philosophy. I'm going to focus on the second question. Although Sellars himself did not delve into this issue in detail, I suggest that a case can be made for thinking that philosophical discourse was itself born as a result of the emergence of the manifest image out of what Sellars calls the original image. So there's another image before the manifest image, where all kinds of objects were understood on the model of persons and their capacities, abilities, and impulses. Recall that for Sellars, the manifest image is itself, in its own way, he says that, a scientific image. It is self-critical and uses explanatory methods of correlational induction to refine and extend the framework, and emerges out of a gradual depersonalization of objects other than persons from the original image. Natural objects in this process are thereby eventually deprived of the full range of the of capacities and abilities of persons that they had in the original image. In this way, in the early stages of the development of the manifest image, nature is understood as included truncated persons, as Sellars calls them, which are mere creatures of habit, acting out routines, broken by impulses, in a life which never arises above what ours is like in our most unreflective moments. On the basis of this model, it can be argued that the gradual change from the original image to the manifest image was the result of the rise of a very early and primitive form of the scientific image, in particular of ancient Greek astronomy and mathematics. Recall that, as we said before, the manifest image is itself, in a sense, a scientific image, as opposed, for example, the original image, which is completely unscientific. Astronomy, with its mathematical discourse on the motion of the planet, ceases to explain a phenomenon with the exemplary narratives of myth, which is, I think, a classic mode of explanation in the original image. Also, although Sellars does not mention it, I think. In this way, a gradual and unthought season is produced between the new science of phenomena and man's self-understanding as a source of values and norms already in antiquity. Thus, it seems that the very manner in which the manifest image comes into existence from the original image produces a gap in man's understanding of nature and his place in it, which I think was registered by the Sophists in ancient Greece, which creates the need for the emergence of a form of thinking whose constitutive aim is precisely to erase the gap in question and restore the disturbed coherence in our understanding of the world and ourselves. And philosophy, at least since Plato, as a discipline, emerges precisely as an attempt to do just that. So, although there are important differences between the ancient and the modern version, of course, of the scientific image, it's in their own distinctive way challenged, I think, the hitherto natural way of understanding nature and ourselves in it by creating a gap between value and being, which philosophy since then aims to bridge. We could perhaps understand this whole historical process where the manifest image challenges the original image and is itself challenged by the scientific image in its modern version as characterized by two waves of disenchantment of nature of ourselves and corresponding scientific revolutions. The first took place already in antiquity, gradually transforming the original image into the manifest image, while the second, Weberian disenchantment, occurred in early modern times and challenged the categorical authority and adequacy of the manifest image itself from the standpoint of an image emerging as, in Hegelian terms, the determinate negation of the manifest image, namely the modern scientific image. The first wave of disenchantment brought philosophy into being, while the second, as an organized discipline at least, while the second gave it its distinctively modern form. In sum, we suggested that the Szelarsian concept of the manifest image and the scientific image are, in effect, meta-philosophical tools which can illuminate issues about the nature of philosophical theses and problems, at least from three different angles. They can illuminate meta-philosophical issues regarding the content, first, the content of different contemporary philosophical views and systems. Second, the development of philosophical ideas in the course of the history of philosophy. And third, the origin or emergence of philosophical problems as such and of philosophy itself as a discipline. This is what they aspire to do. I don't mean that it's a good explanation necessarily. The very fact that Szelars attempts to explicate those three different metaphilosophical issues with the use of the same conceptual tools suggests that those issues are intimately related in a way that makes them distinguishable yet inseparable from one another. So points one and two show that philosophy is intimately related to its internal history, I think, according to Szelars, with the history of philosophy, while point three shows that philosophy is also related in a different way with its external history, with non-philosophical events such as scientific advances or revolutions. So, as was suggested in the first part of the presentation, a critical philosophy worthy of the name would have to be self-conscious, self-reflective, and self-critical. And I think that as he uses them, the notions, as Szelars uses them, the notions of the manifest image and the scientific image in their metaphilosophical can be understood as precisely the concepts through which a philosophical system can become, according to Szelars, at least, self-aware, self-reflective, and self-critical, aware of its own methods, presuppositions, and limits. They also have this function. So that was it. Thanks. Thank you.